I'd like to begin by apologizing sincerely for the offending comments that I've made. I sincerely apologize for conjecturing with the tone of expertise and for doing so in such a disparaging fashion. It's never appropriate to make oneself seem more important or smarter by demeaning others. I knew better, I know better, I'm embarrassed, and I'm sorry.
Jonathan Gruber took his lumps Tuesday in D.C. as Republicans and Democrats both hammered away at his comments about the American people being stupid when it came to Obamacare. But what, if anything, new did we learn? And how, if in any way, were his recommendations on the plan actually put to use? She is president and CEO of the Pacific Research Institute, a San Francisco-based think tank dealing with healthcare issues. Also author of The Pipes Plan, The Top 10 Ways to Dismantle Obamacare. It's a pleasure to welcome back Sally Pipe. Sally, thanks for joining us today.
Well, thank you for having me.
Sally, after everything that we went through on Tuesday, honestly, did we really learn anything new? This just seemed like nothing more than a flogging session, if you will, of a man who really had very little way to protect himself.
Right. Well, of course, he did apologize. And I don't know if you saw the Wall Street Journal today, their editorial calling him Forrest Gump. But I think the American people, you know, just don't believe when they, if they watch the hearing or they read about it in the press, that his apology, I mean, it's too little too late. I mean, he should have thought before he spoke and made these disparaging comments about a lack of transparency and the stupidity of the American people were the only way that the law, Obamacare, could have been passed. So I don't think we learned anything. But the real, really exciting point, Ed, is that the Supreme Court decided to take King v. Burwell, the case, which, you know, was turned down in, by a three-judge panel in the Fourth Circuit. So this January, there will be the hearing to investigate whether or not the subsidies were intended for those people who are on the federal exchanges, which 37 states have the federal exchanges. So Mr. Gruber's remarks are going to be, I think, important. I mean, I don't think the justices will really, you know, base their decision on that, but there's a lot of information out there which, you know, the American people were lied to, not only by Mr. Gruber, but by President Obama. Remember when he said, if you like your health insurance plan, you can keep your plan. Well, people are finding out that that's not the case. And they found out that, of course, that people like Jonathan Gruber were saying that this lack of transparency, if they didn't say that the individual mandate the individual mandate is not a tax, they had to say that so that the Congressional Budget Office could score it and keep it at a lower cost. And that was, you know, definitely deceitful.
Sally, though, do we really need to have another episode here to talk about the lack of transparency and lies? Because wasn't that pretty much already covered? And if you're sitting on the right and if you're an opponent of Obamacare, you knew the lies were there. You knew that they haven't been transparent. So isn't it time to move this forward and kind of put Jonathan Gruber behind us in the fight here?
Right. And Jonathan Gruber, of course, would not say how much he was actually paid by us, the taxpayers. But it looks like it was a lot of money, $400,000 and probably $4 million from all the different states. But it is time that we move on. The Supreme Court case, which the hearing will, we will know in June how the court rules. We have a new Congress coming in January. We'll be looking at things like reconciliation, budget reconciliation on some of the issues like the subsidies, the Medicaid expansion. We'll probably see a vote for full repeal. The president, of course, will veto it. But these things are awakening the American people to the fact of what they actually believe, that only 37% of Americans support
Obamacare. Let me stop you there for a second, Sally, if I can.
Let's get rid of it.
Let me stop you there for a second, but a minute and a half we got left. You use those magic words again, full repeal, and then the president will veto it. All right, let's take it from there. We know this is coming. We know this is what the Republicans want, and we know the president's going to say no. So then what do we do from this point? What really is, what's going to be substantive to do then to overcome that and to get something changed?
Right. Well, first of all, if the court rules that the subsidies for those in the federal exchanges were illegal, we're going to see Obamacare go into a tailspin, a downward spiral, because the employer mandate and the individual mandate will collapse. In the event the court doesn't rule that, we have some important things that can happen, but they won't really happen until January 2017, assuming that the Republicans take the presidency, keep the Senate, and keep the House. Then we will need all of the Republicans to stand behind one replacement plan, which looks at how do we bring affordable, accessible, quality care to all Americans. And that comes from changing the tax code, allowing people to buy insurance across state lines. We do need to think about what will we do with all of those people who say, the 7 million people who are getting subsidies. But how are we going to deal with
everything
those?
You're talking about, though, Sally, is pretty much going to go to the end of 2015, right? This isn't going to happen in a couple of days.
No, no, it definitely isn't. But budget reconciliation, right, if it passes, and we may see, you know, the Medicaid expansion overturned, we may see the subsidies overturned. So there are a lot of exciting things, Ed, that can happen. The American people were right. The polls were right. The American people don't like this law, and it has to be changed.
Reminding everybody again that Sally Pipes' book is called The Pipes Plan, The Top 10 Ways to Dismantle and Replace Obamacare, which is going to be the discourse into 2015 and beyond. Sally, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks, Ed.
All right. America's locked once again into the discourse of black versus white. Michael Steele is here to talk about that and more on Midpoint.